Good evening. Welcome to Left, Right and Centre. I'm Vishnu Shom. On the programme tonight, Maharashtra and Haryana have voted today. Crucial assembly elections, the first after the general elections. Exit polls, and we'll show you the results, indicate a resounding BJP victory in both states. No surprises, and along what many believe were expected lines. On the show tonight, the Union Minister Nitin Gadkari on what these elections are all about and why national issues played a dominant role in the election campaign. We'll also be joined by several other top political leaders and experts as we go through today's voting. A word of caution, NDTV has not conducted an independent exit poll of our own. We'll bring you the results of several such polls and tabulate a poll of polls as well. But let's bring you a few details on what the numbers actually have to say. Let's take a look first at the poll of polls as far as Maharashtra is concerned. Remember, the majority mark is 145. The BJP and the Shiv Sena, this is an average of the polls taken by others. The exit polls, the BJP and the Shiv Sena at 211. The Congress and the NCP at 64, others at 13. So a huge, huge win forecast for the ruling alliance. As far as Haryana is concerned, again, another resounding indicator. In fact, if we were talking about Maharashtra a moment earlier on, it really needs to be seen whether, if this translates into results, there has ever been so wide an election in recent times in the state of Maharashtra, the gap between the two formations. One second, let's take a look at Haryana first. 90 seats, majority mark is 46. Let's just go back, if we can, let's just go back to the Haryana statistics that we were looking at over there. We'll try and bring back the Haryana statistics. Yeah. So, as far as Haryana is concerned, the majority mark 46, the BJP at a whopping 66, the Congress at 14, the INLD and the Akalis at 2, others at 8. Again, a very impressive show if these translate into results. Remember, results day is the 24th of this month. Now, let's give you a breakup of what many of the exit polls have specifically said. And they essentially indicate a resounding win for the BJP. Now, the way it works is there is a wide array of numbers. But I think in all cases, the lowest number for the BJP and Shiv Sena in Maharashtra is actually 192. That's the Z24 TAS result. 192 is the lower, 176, I beg your pardon, is the lower benchmark. There is another one which is even lower than that. That's the India Today Access My India poll. That pegs the BJP and the Shiv Sena at between 166 and 194. And then you've got the upper numbers as well. So some numbers suggesting Republic TV that it could go up almost to 230. So again, all of them indicate quite clearly a sweep as far as Maharashtra is concerned. Let's take a look at what the individual polls are saying about Haryana. We've got those numbers there. Again, for the BJP and the Shiv Sena, it goes between 52 and 80. Between 52 and 80. Remember, the majority mark is 46. So even the lowest, that's by Republic TV, and they have a range between 52 and 63, is well above the majority mark. The number goes all the way to 80. Imagine 80 out of 90 is what NewsX and Pollstrat indicate might happen in the upper range. India News and Pollstrat again say 75 to 80. So again, a huge win there, as far as the BJP is concerned. So what were some of the big issues over here? I'm joined now by the Union Minister, Nitin Gadkari. Sir, thanks very much for speaking with us. It's great to have you. It seems, sir, very likely that the BJP and the Shiv Sena will do very well if these exit poll results translate into electoral results. It seems the BJP will do very well in Haryana as well. Do you believe Maharashtra and Haryana is because of Mr. Modi's leadership, or the lack of leadership, or the lack of cohesion in the opposition?
First of all, the five-year performance of Indian government under the leadership of Modi ji At the same time, the good performance of the both state government, that is the test for the party, for the leadership, and now the people are supporting by and large to the BJP. That is, the credit goes to Modi ji for his developmental agenda, and that is the reason that we are getting good response from the people.
But Mr. Gadkari, in Maharashtra, assuming that you do win, is it going to be looked at as a Modi victory or a Fadnavis victory? Is this again the BJP banking on the image of Narendra Modi, the fact that he is sort of the indisputed leader, as it were, perhaps in this country? Does Mr. Fadnavis not get credit when perhaps it should be due?
It is the BJP victory under the leadership of Modi ji and Fadnavis ji both.
Okay. National issues dominated the campaign both in Haryana and in Maharashtra. In the past, we've seen people voting for national issues in general elections, but regional issues have dominated at the assembly level. That's not necessarily always the case, but by and large, that seems to have been the case. And there's this huge disparity between what the opposition was talking about, where they looked at agriculture, agrarian distress, they looked at unemployment, whereas the BJP focus, certainly at the level of Amit Shah and at the level of Narendra Modi, national issues, Kashmir, NRC, post-Balakot, security. So was this all about national issues?
No, this is not correct. Actually, it is obvious that when 370 and 35A, the Congress and NCP opposed the bill, and now it is to be obvious for the debate on this subject in the election, because this was a national subject. But now the majority decision in Maharashtra, majority mood of Maharashtra's people was related with the developmental activities. The work done by irrigation department, particularly from Devendra Fadnavis ji, was excellent. And at the same time, the support from the Bharat Sarkar was equally good. That is one of the reasons that people have a lot of satisfaction. That's comparing the regime of Congress party of last 62 years and now the 5 years regime of Modi ji and Fadnavis ji. That was really a marvelous work done by the BJP government. And that is one of the reasons that people are in support of BJP.
No, but sir, the entire dichotomy of the debate, on the one hand, the opposition talking about development here, the BJP speaking about nationalism, and it's not just about Kashmir. It's also, for example, about Amit Shah speaking about Veer Savarkar. Why do you think that regional issues didn't dominate the BJP's campaign? Is it because you feel that the pulse of the nation overwhelmingly lies with the sentiment of a strong nation and national security and all of that?
First of all, it is a very clear indication that the national issue is the part and parts of the country. In any election, the national security is the most important subject for the people. And that is the reason that there was a debate on this issue. It is obvious and natural. I feel that public is fully supporting BJP on all this issue. But regarding this state government election, there are a lot of other subjects which was equally important, that is related with the water problem, related with the agriculture problem related with the development, and the performance of the BJP government in both the state was excellent. Now this agrarian crisis and other thing, this is all because of wrong economic policies, bad and corrupt governance, and visionless leadership of the Congress party, because last 62 years, Congress got opportunity to rule the country. And that is the failure of the Congress party and their policies. Today we are facing this problem. We are just coming 5 years. So this is not a big period. And I am confident that within 5 to 10 years, we will resolve the issue and we will make agriculture economically viable. We have taken a lot of decision, and I am confident in due course of time, there will be good positive results.
But sir, you're talking about the agrarian sector. If you look at not just the agrarian sector, but the overall state of the economy, and that's something the opposition focused on, it is a fact that GDP growth is going down. Various indices of growth are going down. There's a hunger index, which is also going up. The Nobel economist, Nobel laureate Abhijit Banerjee, is critical of economic growth and said that India's economy is in a state of crisis. So wouldn't it have been important perhaps for this to have been more vocally stated by several BJP leaders in Haryana and Maharashtra?
Actually, frankly speaking, there is a recession in global economy. Sometimes it is that progress is depending upon demand and supply, and sometimes business cycle is there. So it is a cycle. I feel that the way in which we are taking decisions, I am confident that due course of time we will increase the growth rate, at the same time create more employment potential. As far as MSME minister, I am in charge for that. Previously, the 29% of the growth of the country in the GDP is from MSME. 49% export is from MSME. And up till now, MSME creates 11 crore jobs. So now is a mission for us. Now, out of growth, 50% of GDP from MSME, 60% of export from MSME, and create 5 crore new jobs. We are trying our level best. We are now concentrating on agriculture, rural and tribal sector. We are taking a lot of decisions, creating more employment potential in the rural area, and I am confident in due course of time we will increase the agriculture growth rate. We are also going to encourage handloom, handicrafts, then all different type of industry, particularly related to the rural, agriculture and tribal area. Definitely that is going to give a good progress for the country.
But sir, what are your views on Abhijit Banerjee and his views on the economy?
I feel that the Indian economy is the fastest growing economy. Still, there may be some ups and downs in some sectors, but by and large, we are in a good position and we are developing, emerging as a new strong economy. And in due course of time, definitely we will get good positive results and we will get a lot of improvement in agriculture, at the same time in small scale industries, handloom, handicrafts, khadi, and all different type of industries which are particularly related with the agriculture, rural and tribal. So I am confident that the future of the country, the economic future of the country is very good. And under the leadership of Prime Minister Modi ji, we are already changing a lot of policies, taking new decisions, taking a lot of reform in every sector. I feel that it is definitely going to give a good result to the country.
But sir, there are other parameters as well. For example, the Global Hunger Index. India has been rated as among the poorest performers in the world. Abhijit Banerjee's economics is related to poverty, not the global hunger index per se, but when we are confronted by figures like this and we keep saying that we are doing very well, we'll continue to do much better, are these statistics not something of huge concern?
No, that is the problem, not from created in 5 years. This is the 47 Congress got appointed to rule the country. And the totally failure because of the wrong economic policies, bad and corrupt governance and visionless leadership of the Congress party. We are just 5 years experience of ruling this country. These are the old problem. But I am confident in next 5 years, this 5 years and next 5 years, within 10 years, whatever the decision we have already taken as a policy decision in and making reform in different fields, I am confident that the position will be changed.
But if we just look a little bit at Maharashtra, the Shiv Sena is your ally. It's been an ally with whom you've had problems in the last 5 years. It's been a rocky relationship. How sure are you that going forward, the equation between the Shiv Sena and the BJP is going to be all right?
I feel that there will be no problem. We have already contested election as an alliance in Maharashtra. And after election, we will get a record-break majority. And Devendra will be the new chief minister. And I am confident that the Shiv Sena and BJP will both are very responsible for the progress of Maharashtra, protect the interest of Marathi Manus. And it is really obvious that I feel that it is a natural alliance, the longest alliance in the country, political alliance. And I feel that there will be no problem.
You mentioned Devendra Fadnavis as the chief minister. What if the Shiv Sena were to come to you and say, what about Thackeray? What about Aditya Thackeray? Would that not be something that you would look at as well?
Now, as far as the alliance is concerned, we are contesting the election under the leadership of Devendra Fadnavis. Obvious, it is natural that we are expecting Devendra would be the next chief minister.
All right, Mr. Gadkari, thank you very much for speaking to us, sharing your perspective on several of the issues over there. Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, now of the Congress Party, with us. Dr. Singhvi, you would have seen the poll of polls. You would have seen various agency-wise polls, which project a huge win for the BJP alliance in Haryana and in Maharashtra. Your first reactions to what you're seeing, sir?
I haven't actually seen the figures, but I've heard of them, and subject to my usual caveat about how polls can be wrong and misleading, I don't want to get into that. I think we have to just now accept whatever is the verdict, but let me tell you two or three things. I think this excessively gung-ho attitude of the ruling parties in these places may well be misplaced. I can't be sure about the figures. In Maharashtra, for example, people are forgetting that for 4.5 out of the 5 years, the so-called allies who are now fighting together as the ruling dispensation, the Shiv Sena was the biggest critic of the government and possibly ahead of every opposition party, yep, in viciously criticizing the government.
Yes.
So a marriage of convenience 3 months before elections, I think, is underestimating the electorate's astuteness or the electorate's maturity. People see through this kind of a charade. Number two, as against that, you have a very, very old, well-known, tested coalition of the Congress and the NCP. They've not only ruled for more than 10 years, but they've had a cohesiveness and a coordination which is far, far ahead of the BJP Shiv Sena. I think it prevents vote division. It has prevented bickering. There is subdued resistance and anger within the alliance at the ruling level. Each candidate is snapping at the other's heels. So I don't think that this easy, overwhelming victory is so easily predictable.
No, but sir, if you look
thirdly,
at the...
Thirdly, I think but what Dr. really Singhvi, matters on the ground...
Right, but Dr. Singhvi, let me ask you this. You know, you can disagree with a poll, you can disagree with two polls, but just an average of everything indicates that of 288 seats in Maharashtra, the Shiv Sena and the BJP are up at 211. Now, you can say that this is wrong, you know, it'll be lower. See, fair enough. But what the sense is that the margin of victory, and this is what a lot of people would say, that where is the opposition? Even if it's not this, it's less than this. The margin of the victory means that effectively we don't have an opposition in either of these states, because even in Haryana, the numbers are very different.
I concede that if these polls are right, then assuming that they are 33% less than what they predict, even then the majority would be the same.
Yes.
I entirely concede. Well, what does one do on the evening of a program with polls?
No, that's okay.
They are neither the actual results.
I take your point.
They are speculation.
Right.
You have to deal with reasons. No. One minute. You have to deal with reasons which suggest that these may be exaggerated results. And remember, in India, there is no homogeneity of the kind expected to validate exit polls even. Although exit polls are more accurate than opinion polls, exit polls in India do not display the same degree of homogeneity.
No, they don't. And so that's
so
a,
now
that's
you have
a,
to look at reasons why this may be wrong. Although I concede that even if they are wrong and if I'm right for the reasons, even then the majority may be that.
Okay.
But I'm just saying this one-sided sweep for the reasons I'm saying, and just 5 seconds, 10 seconds, the ground reality of unemployment, of the economic figures, is the third factor which people are underestimating. It's all very well for Mr. Modi and Mr. Fadnavis to constantly beat the drum of 370 and, you know, uniform civil code lying and Ayodhya hone wala and all this. But people ultimately ask hard answers to hard questions.
No, but is it not your worry, Dr. Singhvi? Is it not your worry, Dr. Singhvi, and again with the usual caveat and your caveat that you, what you mentioned, that even if this is 33% off, that in this country, for whatever the reasons are, this national security discourse, this strident nationalism, whether it's associated with Ayodhya or with Kashmir or with NRC, the way it's been spun and the way that it's being believed is what people want to hear. And it's what people are willing to vote on. So therefore, the very real issues that the Congress talks about, unemployment, agrarian distress, farmer suicides, why is it then that there is no connect between that reality, it's a statistical reality, and people casting their vote?
two things. One, to an extent you are right, no doubt, because people do move on emotions. But two, that factor is significantly less in a state election than in the recently concluded national elections. That's a thing which you are forgetting. Thirdly, there is a law of diminishing returns about emotive issues. Our Prime Minister is a master orator and he knows how to spin these. But don't you find that his speeches spinning these same things again and again do have a feeling and an appearance of law of diminishing returns? At the end, the person goes out and asks,
"What do you
say about?"
We don't know. I mean, it's quite possible.
IMF revised rate. I'm prepared to bet you this, that it will be a lesser factor than the national elections, although I can't deny it will be a factor.
Okay. Fair enough, Dr. Singhvi. One final question, if I can, to you. The issue of leadership. Sonia Gandhi has not campaigned extensively, if at all, either in Maharashtra or in Haryana. Rahul Gandhi has campaigned a lot. But in terms of your national leadership, if people are voting still for the image of Narendra Modi or for Narendra Modi, who is the opposition, who is the Congress leader that people can look up to in a country where, you know, this charisma of a leader is something which carries a lot of weight?
While conceding that we have had difficult times from April till recently, both pre-election and post-election, because of the change of mind of Rahul Gandhi, there's no doubt that we have been in difficulty. Again, I think that this is an old stereotype question about the Congress. We have not, when we were in power ourselves, when Sonia Gandhi, Manmohan Singh, Rahul Gandhi belonged to a party which was in power, we never went in for state elections with a declared PM, CM candidate, except in one or two rare exceptions.
Right.
And exceptions prove the rule.
Right.
So I don't think, and secondly, in the state level, I think again it is being overstated. Yes, for a ruling party, Modi's image and persona is very, very important. But people do relate ultimately to the Fadnavises or to the Ashok Chavans, the Prithviraj Chavans, the local leader in Sindhugarh,
okay,
the local leader in Vidarbha.
Okay.
So, you know, there is again a difference of degree, although I must concede that their mascot remains Modi. There's no doubt about it.
Okay. Well, Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, I
doubt
about
the same resonance as the national level.
Fair enough. And that's something we need to debate, whether Modi carries the same weight in the mind of the voter, or is it regional issues which also play a more significant role than perhaps at the national level. Thanks very much, sir, for joining us. Well, we're going to keep on analysing this poll of polls and the individual results. Niranjan Shetty, the spokesperson of the BJP, joins us from Mumbai. Sudhindra Kulkarni with us. Anil Dharkar is coming on in just a few moments from now. Hindol Sengupta with me in the studio, and Dorab Sopariwala as well. Also, Clyde Castro, the spokesperson of the NCP. Let's just bring out those numbers if we can, the poll of polls, and take a look at those numbers. 288 of 288 seats as far as Maharashtra is concerned. What the poll of polls, the average, indicates a resounding BJP and Shiv Sena win over there at 211, with the Congress NCP at 64, others at 13. And if we look at Haryana, again, the margin, that seems to be the real question over here, the real issue over here. 66 out of 90 is what, you know, the poll of polls indicates, the Congress at 14. So let me come to you, Dorab, first. Now, assume for a moment that these numbers may be off. We don't know whether they are. Even if it's 20%, 25% lower than this, in recent times, have we seen this kind of margin in assembly elections in Maharashtra between the two major formations?
You know, last time the Vidhan Sabha elections were fought separately by the BJP and the Shiv Sena. But if you look at the Lok Sabha results by assembly segments in 2014 and 2019, they got 232 seats one time, 227 this time. So in the Lok Sabha this time, they've already won 227 segments.
Right.
So what you're seeing now is about the same.
Is about the same. And in Haryana?
In Haryana, actually, I thought it's better to compare Vidhan Sabha to Vidhan Sabha.
Yes.
And Vidhan Sabha last time, they'd done in the Lok Sabha very well. Vidhan Sabha last time they had only got 33% of the votes, but then they shot up in the Lok Sabha to 58. So again, this number is not surprising. And they won 79 out of the 90 Vidhan Sabha segments in the Lok Sabha in 2019. So if they're winning 65,
so this is the trend continuing,
yes,
right?
Yes, or they've moved to another plane. In 2014, Haryana, they won to in Vidhan Sabha, they won a lower plane of about 33%. Then they moved to 57% in the Lok Sabha. So if they get 50-odd%, then they'll get this number of seats.
And,
Lok Sabha has, Maharashtra hasn't changed much, but Haryana has.
Right. And if you look at issues, it's not necessary that national issues, that a national sort of rhetoric along the lines of a dominant narrative, for example, national security, which is what the BJP is doing, has in the past resulted in appealing to people in states. But there's nothing to suggest that that's not a factor as well.
Yes.
But what I'm trying to understand in your memory, when have elections like this been borne out entirely on these national issues? NRC, Ayodhya, Kashmir, more than anything else.
Bangladesh.
With every leader going on and on.
Bangladesh.
Right.
So my question is, you need to have some. But the question is, here Balakot has become Bangladesh. That is the miracle. Balakot isn't Bangladesh, but it's been made. For instance, by all accounts, the economy isn't doing brilliantly, which is a major factor that
correct.
And, Maharashtra and, has and, a large number and, of suicides.
And, yes.
But the question is, what matters? Cultural context and nationalism are very, very important factors in determining votes.
Yeah.
I mean, Mr. Trump is showing it today, right?
Yes.
So you're seeing it in Erdogan, you're seeing it in Poland, you're seeing it in Hungary. You're seeing it in Italy.
Yeah.
These are very important factors.
Yeah.
And you're seeing it in Britain now with
yes.
Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
So, it's always been underlying and now it's come to the surface. But it's a very strong winning strategy.
Yeah. Niranjan Shetty, was that really at the core of your thinking in Maharashtra? That the elections, the general elections were just a few months back, that the dominant narrative of hyper-nationalism, even if you don't use the word hyper, strident nationalism, is something that worked for the BJP, and that given that these elections were just a few months later, it was likely to continue working over here. So is that the reason why you pick those issues? That it triggers a sentiment and that results in votes. We've seen it a few months back. It'll happen again this time.
I think, Vishnu, it would be very unfair to, assess the BJP's victory in that manner. You need to understand that the CM of the state almost tore the whole of Maharashtra, the entire Maharashtra, and he placed before all the development work that he has done during his five-year tenure. And I think that is what the people of Maharashtra is espouse in as far as the voting is concerned. You can see the difference. Now, basically, they had the people of Maharashtra are very smart enough. They have taken such decision in the past as well. Now, you cannot fool them forever. What I could only say is, yes, they know that whom to believe. Previously, there was a government who is to print something in their manifesto, and then after coming to power, they used to say that it was our printing error. So this is a party which keeps its promise even after the polls and continues to strive to fulfill the promises that it has made in the poll promises.
Anil Dharkar, as a resident of Mumbai, how did you see events playing out? What was the dominant narrative? Because there are other BJP leaders we've spoken to earlier in the day who actually say, something similar to what Niranjan Shetty is saying, that no, talk about infrastructure, talk about metro connectivity in Mumbai. A lot of people have voted on those lines. So it's not enough to say that, the environment is one where we talk only about a dominant narrative, which is a national sort of thing, that people are voting in Maharashtra on local issues. Is that correct, sir? Do you believe that's the case?
Well, not at all. This morning when I was on one of your programs, I had said that when the national leaders, Narendra Modi, Amit Shah, Rajnath Singh, they all came and toured Maharashtra, they did not talk of a single local issue. What did they talk about? They talked about Kashmir, 370, Balakot. They talked about basically nationalism. Now that is the argument which was used. That was the that's what was the driving force in the general election 2019. And this election was a continuation of that. So I expected the results of this election to be the same as the general elections. Because the opposition is so fragmented, the Congress is completely clueless, leaderless. All the workers are, don't know who to look up to. They are completely discouraged. So the local issues which should have been brought up,
yes,
and there are so many of them,
yes,
infrastructure is terrible, agrarian distress. We know this all the time. It's in the newspapers every single day.
Yes.
And my colleague here was talking about what the Maharashtra government has achieved in the last 5 years. I'm afraid that is not true.
All right. Let's give him an opportunity.
Really, to complete, it wouldn't have mattered if Mr. Fadnavis was the CM or anyone was the CM. I think it's the charisma of Narendra Modi has won this election and will continue to do so, whatever the performance of the government.
Okay.
It's a very sad reflection on the electorate and on the voter that they're not able to discriminate between the ultra-nationalism and what are the issues that really matter.
Okay, Niranjan Shetty, quickly reply to that before I go to my other panelists. You wanted to say something. Yes.
I wouldn't like to elaborate more, but I would like to thank Mr. Anil Darkar. At least today he did not blame the EVM hacking. That is what I want to say.
He might blame the hacking in a few days from now.
Probably, yes. Maybe on 24th when
studio. But more seriously, what is the point you're making, sir?
Rajnath Singh, he accused of Narendra Modi, he accused of Amit Shah speaking from the platform about the national issues. Few minutes back, you heard our national leader, Nitin Gadkariji, he spoke how the national issues are important to the common man. Do they want to say that they would have been happy that, you know, that we go and down the knees, on the knees to the Pakistan?
So you're saying two things now, because 5 minutes ago you said that it is regional issues which have decided everything. Now you're saying that
what I wanted to retaliate was, when a national leader speaks, naturally he will speak on the national issues. And it was the Devendra Fadnavis who spoke
about
the state
issue. No, but what stops a national issue talking about agrarian distress? What stops a national talking about farmer suicide?
You need to understand, what did we inherit? The legacy that we inherited, that has to be kept in a box.
No, but there are statistics which indicate that
there will be no yardsticks to be measured if you compare the years of governance.
So if you look at even the global hunger index, the numbers have changed since the last time.
And then compare the 5 years of our governance, allow us, no?
Okay.
Don't you think that it would be an unfair comparison when comparing to the 50 years of governance and 5 years of governance?
No, but then we can say this. We can say this many decades later that they were in power for longer. Okay, but be that as it may.
What I would like to, one thing I would like to say, Mr. Darkar, is that what Mr. Modi said. Yes, they are expecting.
Yeah, Clyde, one second. Okay, Mr. Shetty.
What we can deliver.
All right, Mr. Shetty and Mr. Darkar, one moment.
They can expect only from the people who can deliver.
Yes, I want to go across to Clyde Crasto.
It is all.
If I can just go across to Clyde Crasto of the NCP at this stage. Mr. Crasto, if you look at these numbers. The point
till
which
the
I was talking,
is wise enough.
Mr. Dharkar, one second. I've got other panelists. I will try and come back to both of you. Clyde, these numbers, I think a lot of people would say it's not surprising, but what they would say is perhaps surprising is the margin. Would you accept that the margin which is being projected is huge and something worse than what you had anticipated?
I cannot take anything away from if the people have decided this, then I cannot take anything away from that. But let's we'll wait to see what that margin is on the 24th. But there are a couple of things I want to say, and I didn't disturb anybody, so please allow me to speak. I mean, you know, yeah, Niranjan Shetty, I've been listening to him all the time and I've known him. I mean, it sometimes appears that according to him, you know, all bad things happened before 2014 and all good things started happening after 2014. Now that's his narrative. Now I cannot change that. But I'll tell you something. These exit polls, what they show today, okay, fair enough, we'll know what happens on the 24th. But there are some facts that cannot be changed and some facts that cannot be overlooked. Now, the facts that I'm trying to tell you, and I'll have to give you in a short thing, is that, you know, there is definitely a problem of unemployment in Maharashtra, okay? There has been economic slowdown in Maharashtra. I mean, if you look at the GST collection in the last month, it's over 6,000 crores less. If you look at the revenue collected, it's 2.6% less than the last year. Now, there are issues like farmer suicide. There are issues like farm loans, which have not been given out to people. 50% of farmers have not got their loans. Then there's farm insurance that has not been paid. Their own ally, Shiv Sena, came onto the streets and, you know, they were saying that the insurance was not given. So these facts cannot be overlooked. And if this exit poll showed different numbers, I'm sure you and I would be discussing all these facts that I'm telling you about. So the narrative can keep changing. But at the end of the day, I think, well, whether I may like it or not, I have to respect the mandate of the people if the same thing holds true.
So, you know, let me put that to Hindol. Hindol, the fact of the matter is that everything he's referred to are very strong issues. I don't think you would necessarily even dispute the numbers. Farmer suicides is a statistical problem. Agrarian distress is a statistical problem. Where do we stand in our democracy if all we are going to vote for is strident nationalism, let's hit the Pakistanis, let's ensure that Kashmir is shut down because that's in the national interest, and not talk about what 10 or 12 odd farmers killing themselves every day?
So I think there is a gross simplification on both sides of the argument. I don't think the Indian voter is so foolish. If the Indian voter was so foolish that a party's campaign could completely blank out all local issues, then the BJP after 2014 would have not lost in any election. But in fact, they did lose in Delhi, they did lose in Bihar and so on and so forth. It was a tight race in Gujarat and so on and so forth, right? I think the voter is wise. There is one key thing we have not discussed. It's the point of the voter trusting somebody to do something about the problems. No doubt that there are problems. But I think both Mr. Khattar and Devendra Fadnavis, to a degree, along with everything else of the BJP's electoral machine, have been able to convince the voter, if these numbers of your exit polls are true, have been able to convince the voter that they're serious about fixing some of these problems. And I think, especially because there is no real competitor as far as the face is concerned, the voter is inclined to believe these men if these numbers are true.
Okay.
And we cannot take away from the fact that if I were a voter, I would have to trust somebody to deliver.
Okay.
And if somebody goes, I mean, you look at the kind of things that Devendra Fadnavis, for instance, from Mumbai is doing. Well, look, his metro rail project, right? I have family living in Bombay. And yes, there were many people who objected to the tree cutting on RA. Yes. But there were equal, if not more, numbers of people who actually said, we desperately need this metro line. Our train system cannot take it anymore. And there was a sense that at least this man is trying to do something. Maybe he's not succeeding entirely, but he's trying to do something. It's the same with the coastal road. It is stuck in court, yes, but at least there is an intention, there is a plan, a beginning has been made. A desperate voter, I think the people in Mumbai today are desperate for governance, right? A desperate voter will repose their trust in somebody who at least is making a beginning. I think the same is true for Mr. Khattar also.
Okay, Sudhindra Kulkarni, you've been waiting very patiently. Would you say, Mr. Kulkarni, that on the one hand, in Maharashtra, as far as the opposition is concerned, you've got Sharad Pawar, always a resilient fighter, holding together an opposition or leading an opposition, which has essentially been flopping, it's been failing. People have been leaving alliances, parties, and that there is a lack of a cohesive face, a real opposition leader to sort of challenge the image of Narendra Modi. Does it boil down to image of leaders in this election?
There's no doubt that as campaigners go, the real hero of this election was Sharad Pawar. He is nearly 80 years, but the manner in which he campaigned is an inspiration for all political parties. a never give up kind of attitude, even though it is well known that the NCP, his party, and the Congress are not going to form the government. There are indeed problems before the people, the agrarian distress, unemployment, economic slowdown. These are both national issues as well as state level issues. But as Hindol pointed out, people choose to vote for one party and choose not to vote for another party on the basis of their own perception of who can govern better. And in this election, the alliance of the Congress and NCP have utterly failed to convince the electorate that they are a better alternative. There was simply no alternative in this election. And even though people were not terribly happy with the governance of the BJP Shiv Sena government, they came to the conclusion that let's give a second chance. That is, if these exit polls hold true. We know that there was, for nearly four and a half years, it was the Shiv Sena that was acting as the opposition party, even though it was part of the coalition. Nevertheless, so complete is the collapse of the Congress and the NCP. There's so many local leaders of the NCP, there was an exodus from NCP to the BJP. The Congress has no leadership at all. The central leadership of the Congress has actually given up on BJP, on Maharashtra. Apart from Rahul addressing a few election rallies, the central leadership was completely absent, whereas the central leadership's visibility, not just visibility, but their defining narrative, that is Prime Minister Modi and other leaders of the central leadership,
yes,
they had a decisive effect on the narrative of this election. It's a combination of that national issues and to some degree the lack of a strong anti-incumbency that is likely to help Devendra Fadnavis' government.
Okay, I just
and wanna... the national issues have, yes, sort of suppressed the people's disappointment, disillusionment, and even to some extent anger at the entrenched problems of unemployment, slowdown, agrarian distress, etc.
Sure. Clyde, was the NCP let down by the Congress in these elections, that they lacked a cohesive strategy, and not just at the state level but in terms of central leadership?
No. We were not let down by the Congress. See, this is a narrative that I've been hearing in the last couple of debates that I've been with. We worked together on the ground. We were there together. Yes, Mr. Kulkarni said certain things. Well, some things may hold true, but we have worked together. We've been there together on the ground level. And well, if we've not been able to get across to people, if people have still voted on the other side, well, that doesn't show how much hard we've worked, but we have worked together. And We will make sure that we will sort out whatever those things that we could not narrate to people or convince them, that can be done, and from here it's only going to be positive for us.
All right. Before I wrap this up by once again looking at that poll of polls, I want to go back to Dorab. Exit polls versus opinion polls. You're the master of this entire business. What has been more accurate in the past?
It varies, but the question is, a decisive poll like this, 10 polls all going the same way.
So basically, everybody can't go wrong is what you're saying.
Yeah, I mean, this is the public's. The virtually no opinion polls have been carried out because nobody wants to spend the money.
No. Yeah.
So, I think what's happened is that the NCP has got a leader, but all its troops have gone to the BJP. The Congress doesn't have a leader. It's got its troops with it. So, in one case, you've got no leader. In one case, you've got no troops. In Maharashtra, the sugar barons go where the money is. That's the ideology. The sugar barons have moved en bloc.
Right.
So that's the way it works.
Right. Well,
it's a very simple thing, actually.
I want to take a look at the poll of exit polls again as we wrap this up. Let's take a look first in Maharashtra, get closing comments after that, and Haryana as well. If we look at where, there we have it, 145 is the majority mark out of 288 seats. BJP and Shiv Sena had 211. So, I mean, what are we talking about? And this is an average. That means that, you know, I mean, it's sort of both ways. There are some which have actually projected lower, some which are projected very high. So that's just the average. It's a reasonably fair guesstimate of where things might actually be. By and large, majority mark
27 in the Lok Sabha.
Yeah. So as you were mentioning, it's exactly on the same line.
Yes.
Is it higher?
It's higher, but you know, as we know, this is an average.
Correct.
So the question,
correct,
if you go 20 up, 20 down,
right,
you're in the same ballpark.
Yeah. But Haryana, you mentioned,
yes,
is more significant.
Yes.
Just one second, Dorab. 90 seats, the BJP projected, poll of polls, not a projection, but a poll of polls, at 66, the Congress at 14, the INLD and the Akalis at 2. Your point about Haryana, Dorab?
Haryana, Vishnu, they won 79 segments in the Lok Sabha. So obviously, you know, they've been able to hold Maharashtra,
yep,
and they've not been able to hold the 79 segments. But, you know, I think it's still a bloody good performance. They'll probably get 50% of the votes.
Yeah. If you look at the lowest numbers in Maharashtra, it's 166 is what India Today and
no,
Access My
it's
India
166
said.
To 194.
Correct. But the lower scale is 166.
Yeah.
Even that number by itself is huge in terms of the majority mark which is required, which is 145. It goes between 166 at the lower end, and it goes up to 230.
I tell you, that's very strange, because
243.
Because last time the Lok
Sabha, CNN,
BJP and the Shiv Sena fought separately, and they got 185 seats.
Right.
And now you're saying they got 166 when they fight together? It sounds, the lower end sounds rather low, is all I can say.
Yeah.
When they fight separately.
So if that lower end is incorrect, as you suggested,
no,
it
it's
is.
It's unlikely.
Then, you know, that the overall number might actually be higher than what
that's right.
The average Hindu.
I want to make one comment, yeah, here, since you guys are discussing Maharashtra. If Devendra Fadnavis wins this, and wins this with the numbers, especially at the higher end, there is a transition that will happen in the next generation after
of
the
Prime BJP
Minister
leaders.
Of
he
BJP
established
Lord,
himself as
BJP
as an
after
as a national
Mr.
leader,
Modi,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Devendra Fadnavis ceases to be merely Chief Minister of Maharashtra if he wins.
Where does
in
this leave
this
Nitin
manner.
Gadkari, incidentally?
So this we will of course have to see, and there might be many permutation combinations
really
and many sort of, you know, people who might be vying for the same position, but definitely Devendra Fadnavis takes his claim as a national leader if he wins in this manner, if these numbers hold true.
Sudhindra Kulkarni, would you agree that, you know, this is one way or the other, assuming that, you know, I mean, the BJP comes back into power with the Shiv Sena, Devendra Fadnavis, you know, I mean, he becomes, you know, moves to a higher plane. He's not just a regional leader. He's a stronger national leader, as, you know, in the BJP. Would you agree that that's where he's headed?
I certainly agree. Devendra Fadnavis is young. He's very articulate, very self-confident. And even though the performance of the government may not have been spectacular, he has emerged as a chief minister with very wide acceptance across the state, including the various caste lines, you know, which as far as caste goes, he had a certain vulnerability. He has overcome that vulnerability and established himself as a very strong leader in the state, and he certainly has a place in national politics as years go by.
Right.
But I want to say one thing, that if these exit polls hold true, the Congress has to do a lot of very serious, honest introspection. Maharashtra was a fortress for the Congress for decades together. And if it ends up being the fourth party of the four parties in the fray, then the Congress really has a lot of introspection to do.
Okay.
The country needs a strong opposition party. The Congress has to reform itself.
Okay. How often have we used the word introspection and the Congress in the last recent set of elections? Well, you're going to leave it over there. I'd like to thank all of you very much for joining us. It seems to be an overwhelming win in Haryana and Maharashtra for the BJP. We'll take a short break. A lot more coming up on NDTV 24/7.